Certainly there was a unique group of people.
A very exciting, crazy, avant-garde, on the edge kind of place.
It was a lot of fun to work with that stuff.
It was a small world. It was a small world of filmmakers.
In the early 70s, the administration of the University of South Florida opted to connect with the community through the creation of a fine arts department.
Can't afford a football team, but we'll have an art school, and that will establish our connection to the community. It's, of course, about USF and the film department. You know. So that's what they were going for, you know, was a real connection with the community, partly through film.
I went to USF, and I was looking at their mass comm college, and they had a film program there, which was more like get together in big crews and learn a specialty, and you know, and so I did that for a year. But then it drove me crazy trying to work with a crew, and I happened to find out about the cinematography program in the fine arts department. Went over there and took a look at it, and decided that would be a lot more like it.
I had come from a small college and realized that their art department was a little too small for me when I was taking their ceramics class, and the teacher said I can only do one bong and one ashtray. So coming to USF, it was amazing. I tried silk screening, I tried painting, I tried sculpture. I thought I was going to end up in ceramics because that was my passion at the time. I had seen in the brochure that they had a history of animation class, and we actually had to create an animation for the project. So that's what got me into the film part of USF, which was, you know, finally learning how to run a camera to do single frame animation. And from then I realized that was magic.
I remember my first walking into whatever that room was called, the projection room, and I had Gunvor Nelson sitting in front of me, Scott Bartlett sitting to the right of me, and a whole bunch of teachers and other film people all around me. And it felt like I was home, that I was going to be given the freedom to sort of like giving you enough rope to hang yourself.
It was a time of everybody experimenting, everybody in their 20s for the most part, really trying to push the envelope, as all art students do with their work.
There was an acceptance of pretty much anything that went on. It was like, well, everything was good, you know, and maybe it wasn't all good, but it was just good to do something.
I got involved in doing documentaries and things that have a storyline or some kind of a thematic center, an emotional center. But I still feel like, even when I'm doing those, that there really are no rules. And that's probably because of early training. I mean, was it training? It was something.
I was hired, and so was Will Hindle, and so was Stan Vanderbeek, three filmmakers all at the same time. Oh, and Harry Hurwitz was there too. Four filmmakers. We had it pretty good, you know?
Hindle was a very inspiring guy. Because he didn't get caught up into using a particular camera, using a particular this or that. He wasn't a wirehead, but he still managed to execute these visions that he had, which I had never seen before, and do it in a way that he made you feel you could do.
I really didn't want to see his films yet. I didn't want to be influenced because I kept hearing about them. You know, Chinese Fire Drills, Watersmith, all these films left such a great impact on people that I really didn't want to be hit by that yet.
His whole thing was that you looked at the footage once and that was it. You better pretty much have it down in your head because you can never touch it. You know, you don't make a work print of it either. That was his thing too. You don't have to make a work print. You should just sort of have absorbed the whole essence of the raw footage, and you should be able to then create this wonderful experience. He made me nervous.
Will was pretty hard on women, really hard on women. And everybody, of course, feared him because of this. I don't particularly like that aspect of his personality. You know, it's tough enough to create, but you don't need to have somebody who's smacking you over the head with dogma and misogyny and all this stuff to just add on to this pressure.
I used to carry film in my pocket because I just thought film was cool to look at, and I would show people how great it was. And I remember it was actually in his class that I came out with the first shape of my film sculpture, and I had it, and you know that cinchy sound that it, when you twist the film and it makes that squeaky sound, or if you pull a strip off a roll and you pull too tight, it sort of, and you know that you're making those little scratches all over the film. And I remember I had that piece of footage in my hand, and I start playing with it, and I started making that sound, you know, and I could see that he was sort of looking at me like, what is she doing touching that film? You know, why does she have that film in her hand for?
You know, Nancy went on, continued on, has continued on with her sculptures, and has been winning many awards. It's terrific.
Even though I gained a lot from him, I did absorb a lot, I appreciated his work, and I know that he was, other students really enjoyed him and, you know, got along well with him. He was a different guy.
Hindle eventually left USF in the mid-80s to build a studio on 15 acres in Alabama. He died there in 1987. A neighbor rescued and hid his films to prevent his mother from destroying them. Hindle made her swear to never allow anyone to transfer them to video. His wish holds true even today.
This is Harry Hurwitz, one of the great teachers I ever had. And Harry was totally the man that got me to understand the history of film. I mean, he showed us films from the very first films all the way through the German and Expressionism, French, classical period of the 30s and 40s, 50s. But he had such a talent for expressing the art that was in the film. He had such a love and respect for the filmmakers, the difficulty. He was a director. And he understood how difficult it is. That's the other thing. As much as we make fun of good movies and bad movies, just to get a movie done is still a miracle. I mean, even in this time and day, and even if you're making a movie for $700,000, which is chump change, it's still an amazing thing. And he instilled in me that respect for film.
In 1976, a unique group of University of South Florida Fine Arts Department students and faculty members, led by Charles Lyman, spawned a congenial gathering of film and video artists to attract well-respected film and video makers from across the U.S. and Canada. The idea? The conference held at Chinsegut Hill, a university-owned antebellum estate in the citrus groves of nearby Brooksville, would provide connections versus credentials. Winners require losers, so there would be a non-competitive atmosphere with no categories, no awards, and minuscule remuneration for invited guests.
Most vivid, and then there are vignettes down the years, but getting started was in a way terrifying, you know, because the chances of success were so small, you know, it seemed to me.
The conference held in spring would rely heavily on the sunny, warm climate to lure filmmakers south. The programming and general structure would provide a common ground on which regional and video artists could work, eat, drink, and play with established artists, critics, curators, and programmers. This would provide much-needed exposure for Southern artists and a network for independent filmmakers across the continent. Charles Lyman, with a coalition of tireless volunteers including Stan Cosma, David Audette, Peter Melarano, Nancy Cervenka, Bob Gilbert, and Nancy Yaseko established the first Chinsegut Film Festival.
We were some fairly intelligent people I mean, not smart enough to get jobs or anything like that, but we were some fairly intelligent people. And we were coming out of the 60s. We pretty much all got out of high school at the end of the 60s. And the 60s was the decade of promise and limitless, and the sky's the limit, and was a real dream decade.
All I wanted to do, I wanted to be part of whatever everyone else was doing, which was this group, you know, we were a group of filmmakers or artists or whatever, getting together to project anywhere, anytime, you know, wherever we could point a projector. So my memory was that they were having a big party, basically, and it was going to be in this place out in the Brooksville, which at that time was pretty much no man's land.
The complete new age, new media, let's project it on the ceiling and let's get the planetarium involved, and can we get a satellite feed from my buddy in California? So we had it all going on at the same time. And so it was a great time and a place to be learning.
It was a really eccentric, eclectic group of people who got together around film to show their works in progress, and to also, we saw film by very established artists also, mostly shorts, independent shorts, really neat stuff, really stuff from when film was splicing actual bits of celluloid.
Not so much that did Shinseki influence my career, but I think teaching at USF did, because I began to appreciate more of the films that I began to look at while I was a teacher there, while I was a professor at USF.
I wasn't a filmmaker the first time I attended the Chinsiga gathering, I believe in 1977. I was director of the Media Arts Center, Image, Film, and Video Center in Atlanta, and I wanted to know more about a genre of filmmaking that I wasn't particularly well acquainted with, and that was experimental or avant-garde or personal, however you want to call this genre. And that's what I found at Chinsiga. It was not only a great education, but I also met regional filmmakers who became my colleagues and friends later as I became a filmmaker, possibly partly because of my experience at Chinsiga.
This is Charles Lyman's house in Brooksville, and he had in his backyard, he had a farm or a ranch, and he had a huge installation piece that was constructed, and he did a lot of, this is where I saw my first experimental installation work, where he had scrims and screens and he would project onto different things at night. Everything has to happen at night when you're doing outdoor installation.
Lyman's interest in unconventional screening situations, a result of his academic background in design and architecture, helped sculpt the festival program with installations, performances, and extra filmic events created by a hand-selected list of artists. These events exhibited a wide variety of form and intent from multiple image sources projected onto any material that reflected, refracted, or diffused to the carefully composed internal reference systems of performance art. Free play and visual experimentation opened a variety of experiences, creating a media buffet and an all-you-can-eat treatment of imagery.
This is really a great interior, man. We just put the screen up there, and then we arranged all the chairs here. We even had this place up here, you know, for balcony viewing. And some people slept up there. In fact, a lot of people slept here, too. And this is the source of one of the first Chinsigas. All those windows had to be covered up with black plastic. So I remember, let's see, I remember Pialesco performing right down there.
I think it was the first time that I was down there when we were in the little stone cottage that was in the middle of the The orange grove and I, girl from the north, had never been in an orange grove when it was in flower. And so riding in along the road, along this path with this aphrodisiac smell of the orange blossoms was my first stage of this kind of discovery of the Florida wilds. The second was passing by several wildly disproportionate bulls, which apparently were massively expensive breeding bills, Brahmin bulls, who knows what they were, but they looked like a kind of a dinosaur. So the smell, this incredible bull, worth more than I will make in my lifetime. And then we arrive at the little stone cottage in the forest, and so it was the you know, the anticipation was rewarded by these things, and then meeting a kind of a bizarre and fabulous and very, very intense group of people gathered for many days and nights of film. The thing that was unique about it was a small festival, and you got to really know everybody that was there, and many people were working outside the frame of just films, and so it seemed quite a high standard of, I mean, as high a standard as I'd seen anywhere, really.
It was a time to see things close up that took your work to another level, I think, to have people come in from New York and California who were more involved in film than we were. I mean, we were still going to school, we were going after degrees, but these people were making a living with their art, and I think that helped push us all a little bit to see that there was a future out there in film.
I'd thought about getting a brain pacemaker, but I gave up the idea when I got the extra head. I've wanted another head since I was a little girl. My father used to say, if you had another brain, you'd be a half-wit. Becoming a half-wit became my goal in life.
Artists, by their very nature, are so undisciplined.
I came from that very disciplined theater, train, dance background, and you came from the streets and the alleys and your film training. So we were always arguing about the approach and how the act would look and just different things we should do with it.
And by doing their creative artwork, they are saying, no, we're not going to die. You know, they are really confronting mortality, and not to get overly romantic about it, but they, and I think Chinsigut is kind of a wonderful place for people to check back in and connect back up. And as long as they don't have too much way of expectations, which I don't think any independent filmmaker has much in the way of expectations, you know, it should be a satisfying moment, you know. But if you expect too much, it might be less than satisfying.
It definitely helps to be a little insane.
In the early 80s, the Chinsigut Festival moved from the university's Antebellum Retreat to the Tides Beach and Bath Club, a survivor of the modern era of coastal resorts and the honeymoon destination of Marilyn Monroe and Joe DiMaggio. Many of the events acquired an aquatic air, including underwater projections, floating screens, and dancers entering backstage by swimming in from the Gulf of Mexico. With its patios, pools, piano bars, and palm trees growing through the bathroom roof, the Tides itself was an ongoing performance installation.
Who can argue with being at the Art Deco Motel on the beach that Marilyn Monroe and Joe DiMaggio had chosen as their honeymoon spot? I mean, there was a certain sort of faded glamour to that. But I always went because of the people.
You meet so many interesting people artists and the people who come to those events, and we would hold them for 2, 3, 4, 5 days, so you had this sort of immersion thing, and so you really had a chance to get to know people, either come to love them or dislike them a lot, and you were exposed to a lot of different approaches to filmmaking.
Let's see if she can hit something. Whoa. She hit it, but she does not want to cry.
Actors and directors and writers and filmmakers, and they watch movies and they talk about them. They play volleyball together. They have meals together. The Robert Flaherty Film Seminar is somewhat like that. The people socialize while they're watching movies. And many film festivals have that atmosphere. That's why they're called festivals, because it's a joy, a celebration of the art of cinema.
Looking at this program for the 1983 festival, I'm remembering that a lot of the people whose work was shown then, those were many of the people that I was interested in writing about during that time when I was contributing to art papers and some of the other independent film and video magazines. Among the folks who were at that 1983 festival, I wrote about Dan Curry. I wrote about Mitchell Kriegman's video, My Neighborhood, and ended up inviting Mitchell Kriegman to the Atlanta Film Festival to do a installation piece that he had created around telephones. I also wrote about the work of Nancy Yaseko, Growing Up with Rockets. That encountering filmmakers at Chinsegut was also a sort of lesson in making connections between individuals and the work that they create, that they don't necessarily follow, that someone like Pat Alesco might not be a big party girl, even though her performance would lead you to think so. We have had such great experience trusting each other for all of the collaborative genius that nobody can bear to give it up, you know, hoping that it'll happen again, that it'll, you know, refire into some other kind of, you know, fireworks.
I have to say, part of it is college buddy bond, but also people were growing up and growing together at that same time. Say you have a bunch of people that went through business school together, you know, they might not have that same bond today. They might know all each other. They might keep in touch, but at the same time, there wasn't that sense of self-expression that everybody shared, that witnessed each other experiencing.
We have stayed in touch, and I'm wondering, you know, was it a function of what was going on in the art department, or was it actually what we did with Chinsegut, because it was one of those things that school was over, but you could still come back, and it was had a reunion quality, but it was tied in with, you know, some part of what you were doing. Even if you were working for a TV station or something, you still were connected to the media.
Many years after Chinsegut, I'd say back of 15 or so years afterwards, I was looking for a sound recordist to go to Peru on a documentary that I was working on, and someone suggested Ray Day, who was someone I had met and knew briefly from Chinsegut, and that was in, we worked together in Peru in the year 2000, and Ray has ended up going to a lot of remote places in the world as the sound recordist on my documentaries.
I really enjoy that more than I would doing features or even independent features or anything like that, because that's small crews, three or four people. We go out wherever, and you're creating all the time, even whether it's for television or what. It's video. Sorry, Will. Film left years ago, unfortunately, and for quite a number of years, from about 1984 to 1996, 7, 97 maybe, I was still carrying around a Nagra tape recorder, a couple microphones, and wasn't connected to the film camera, and was sometimes assisting and doing sound and lighting and all of that. Then video, it just evaporated about 1998. Right on up to now. No more film at all.
Hey! What? Video was available as a pencil and paper, then you will really start seeing good work. But you've seen this explosion today with the digital world, and I don't know if there's any more better work. There's a lot more work, and it's certainly more difficult to weed through, and film festivals are... I'm on a grants panel for the state of Florida. There's a film festival in every city in this state, and it's big. You know, there's an incredible number of entries, and a lot of that's fueled by the digital world.
Stop looking! Stop! Stop!
That it is much easier to make images these days, and consequently, with that sort of ease of availability, it becomes less sort of sacred, in a way. I mean, for those of us that came along in days when if you wanted an image, you had to take a still frame and process it in the dark and then print it in the dark, and you walk out in the light and you see this sort of revelation of the reflection of the world. And today you have a cell phone that can do that.
See, I want your attention, and I'll do anything to get it. I'll do anything to get it.
MTV, I mean, going back to the early 80s, and there was all this explosion of imagery. I mean, that was really sort of the first explosion. And they took the ideas from independent filmmaking world and put them into a commercial venue and basically ripped off a whole group of image makers.
Unfortunately, all my films are gone now because 4 years ago, the building we lived in here on this property burned to the ground one night, and all my films and my cameras and all my editing equipment just went up in smoke, quite literally, and all of that is gone to me now. I use the insurance money to go out and buy new video equipment, which 4 years later I still haven't used because I think I'm still mourning the loss of my films. It's like losing, your arm or something like that. It's part of your flesh and blood in a way when you make something, and to have all of them disappear in one big horrible burning moment is pretty unbearable.
Digital technology is a boon. It makes my work easier. It helps me to tell my stories in a way that film and the double system camera and Nagra sound recorder were awkward in the situations I go into.
Whatever technology you're using, the challenge is to make compelling stories that show us more about ourselves and the world. Mm-hmm.
In 2003, David Audette, a self-described tribal elder, organized a team to carry the torch at a new location under a new name.
It's a festival for the city, and it's to hopefully last a long time.
Ebor Festival of the Moving Image. The Ebor Festival used the same model with a twist, a congenial gathering of film and digital artists. The festival focused on new, non-traditional filmmaking, live performance, digital sculpture, and site-specific installations. Audience members were encouraged to mingle and interact with the filmmakers, most of who would attend, many as Chinsegut alumni.
I was talking to someone who's been kind of on the periphery of Chinsegut, Judy, who went to RISD, and she was saying, you know, when I went to art school, we had a tight cadre, and we did things together, and we, you know, we had these experimentations, and we were pulling all this together, but when school was over, when we graduated, that was it. We just kind of dispersed. And she was just amazed that, you know, this same cadre comes back and, you know, either now to Ybor to reconnect, to, you know, refresh themselves, to be reinvigorated by somebody else's work and ideas.
Anytime you want to say something or do something that's out of the box, and I believe me, the box is getting smaller and smaller, then, you know, seems like there's very few places for that to happen. And to be able to provide one of those spaces is always an honor, even if it's hellish to do, it's hellish to get people to get on board for it, but it's worth the trouble most of the time, you know. What's your chords on this one?
What are we, just any?
So, yeah, burn, burn.
Burn, burn, burn. E and A.
Okay, I've heard of them.
Yeah. Only want to be with the ones who burn, burn, burn. What's love with a cigarette?
The documentaries are more like a recurring disease. You get involved in one and it will take all these years to do it. And when it's done, you know, it's great. And you're completely worn out and you have absolutely no intention of doing another one and pouring a lot of time and resources and writing grants and all that kind of stuff. And then, you know, somehow you get weak, your immunity to foolish acting becomes weak and you end up involved in another documentary. But right now we're on hiatus. We're documentary free right now. So we can have some of the finer things in life, like pay the electric bill and stuff like that.
In all these many years, I never stopped feeling that everywhere I go and everything I do, even right now as we're sitting here, I frame the shot up. It's just a natural thing. I think I was born to be a filmmaker.
I do TV commercials. I do public service announcements. Do a little bit of documentary stuff, a little bit of independent stuff. And, you know, like everybody else aspires to doing something down the road that will be tasty.
I make sculptural beaded jewelry and sculptures of beaded jewelry.
Art making starts from a place in which you are trying to communicate or present something beautiful or tragic or sad or happy, and that's important, to create something, not just consume. So to me, a lot of it is about casting off the material aspects of the world.
Better to have ideas and no money than money and no ideas.
I only want to be with the ones who burn, burn. With little to win and nothing to regret. Well, I'm trading rubies for gasoline. Marijuana makes me nervous. Gin makes me mean. I'm speaking in tongues, looking for what's true. I'm red on the outside, bluer than you. I only want to be with the ones who burn. We'll be right back.
No kidding.
Jinsegae, it was a lot of fun, a worthwhile experience, and now it's time for another generation to do it.